of the heart. It is supposed to be the site of the soul and the organ of love. It's a pump. I don't know much about the soul. As far as love is concerned, I think there are better organs for that. But certainly it is a pump. And as far as a pump is concerned, we can make a pump.
If it were my decision, and I had to make a decision between dying or having the artificial heart, I would take the artificial heart, hands down, because life is precious to me. And that's all I'm asking for a particular patient, for him to look at the complications and make the decision himself.
I honestly believe that although the efforts are certainly well-intentioned, that they're jumping ahead of the technology that's available today.
I think they could probably keep a human being alive with the thing in place to perhaps the same degree that they'd be able to keep an experimental animal.
Heart surgeons don't often fly 850 miles to go to a funeral. But this dignified ceremony in a Seattle suburb was the end of a much publicized paragraph in medical history. The surgeon, William DeVries, assured of his place in medical history, had good reason to come from Salt Lake City to pay his last respects to his patient, the late Dr. Barney Clark. Before that first case hit the front pages of the world, the story had been quietly building locally in Salt Lake City, a mountain community that's financially and morally dominated by one particular view of the world, the Mormon religion. Financial, moral, and technical questions were thrashed out both here and in Washington, D.C., as the University of Utah campaigned for permission to implant the world's first permanent total artificial heart, a campaign they won in June 1982.
What was his occupation? Is he going to have any chance of him getting back to work?
The surgeon's was not the only voice heard on the question of who the first patient should be.
At the university, and I think that's going to turn out to be a plus for him.
A selection team of six experts considered not just medical facts, but candidates' overall family and economic situation.
As we work with this.
Well, I like that. Does he have any particular outstanding financial problems that we have to consider or work with?
Well, at the moment, I think it looks pretty good, Bill.
Another influential member of the patient selection team was psychiatrist Dr. Claudia Berenson.
We were looking at motivation, which was looked at very carefully. Why does this guy want to put himself forward as wanting an artificial heart at this time? And we look at an attempt to evaluate his defenses, particularly his defenses against anxiety.
By late summer, the team still had no patient who was both willing to sign the consent form and also passed all their tests. But logistically, the stage was set. Surgical, technical, and nursing teams had been trained and rehearsed on dummy runs, and a special room had been prepared at one end of the intensive care unit. A secure source of compressed air to power the artificial heart had been installed by the bedside. But pumping and controlling this compressed air took a surprising amount of technology. It was the size and weight of this drive cart that led some experts to call the operation premature, while admiring the organization behind it.
Technical achievement is not the question here. Really, we're talking about what is the long-term prospect for that patient, what is going to be the cost, both to the patient and to society, for maintaining patients like that? who will need, obviously, a power source by the bedside. They will be tethered to their power source. And the family, who will have to face the fact that this is going to most likely be a very short-lived experience.
Many people have asked us the question as to, is not it fully implantable, why then would you do it? Why don't you wait 10 years when it's implantable and then do it? But the key is informed consent. Why should I let people die when I can give them the chance to live, if they're willing to accept the limitations of the external pumping system?
Imitating nature by making artificial organs is a matter of stripping things down to essentials. The heart, seat of the soul, organ of love, is indeed just a pump. As it contracts and expands, four valves direct a flow of blood around the body. The right half of the heart, a low-pressure pump, sends blood to the lungs to pick up oxygen. The left half pumps this oxygen-rich blood around the high-pressure system of the rest of the body. Dr. Robert Jarvic designed the plastic and metal version that was used in Salt Lake City.
The artificial heart is composed of two sides, a right and a left blood pump. Each of these has its own compressed air line, which brings the air in from an external drive system and controls the flow of blood out of the heart through a diaphragm pumping mechanism. In this cutaway heart, we can see the diaphragm moving up and down as the compressed air is pumped in and out by the external drive system. The blood would enter through the inflow valve in this position as the diaphragm comes down, and when the diaphragm comes up, it would force the blood out the outflow valve. It's a very simple mechanism. This device needs to flex approximately 40 million times per year.
It's ingenious, but was it ready for human use? Just a year and a half previously, Jarvic himself thought not. If the artificial heart is ever to achieve its objective, he wrote, it must be more than dependable. It must be forgettable. And that big drive cart is not an easy thing to forget.
Dr. DeVries really was the individual who pursued the use of the heart in humans. And, for example, I initially did not agree that it was the thing to do at this time, because we still have the large drive cart. But when we reviewed it and thought about it, and I also agree now, that in terms of the life expectancy of that individual, in terms of degree of confinement that a patient with end-stage heart disease has in bed and the suffering that's there, it certainly is ethically justified to do it. I would hope that the first patients to receive it are the kind of people that like to look on the good side. We need an optimist with a sense of humor for the first case.
What they got was Dr. Barney Clark. He had a sense of humor, terminal heart disease, and the Mormon family support the selection committee had been looking for. Clark signed the 11-page form consenting to the procedure at 8:30 p.m. on the 29th of November. 24 hours later, according to the agreed protocol, he signed it again. The first incision was made at 11:27 p.m. on the 1st of December. By the time Clark's natural heart was snipped out to a musical background of Ravel's Bolero, it was 7 minutes into the following day. The artificial left ventricle was in by 1:55 a.m., but the natural heart had become so flabby that its stump wouldn't hold the surgeon's stitches. DeVries patiently redid the suture lines twice before he was satisfied. Not until after 4 o'clock in the morning was the artificial heart in full control of Clark's circulation. Later that morning, the surgeon had the satisfaction of looking down on a man who would almost certainly have been dead by then but for his intervention. And at 1 p.m., he came down to the hospital cafeteria to tell the world.
Interesting thing happened last night. We had the team that had been prepared for literally 3 or 4 years at the University of Utah took a patient that probably would have been dead at midnight and removed his heart and placed a mechanical heart in his chest. And it was
almost a spiritual experience with everybody in the room. The entire team worked together so nicely.
10 weeks previously, DeVries had reflected on what this moment would be like.
It makes a great many changes in your personal life. The notoriety that comes with this, and it's a trade-off. You know, some things you get out of it, they're good, and some things you get out of it are very bad. And, you know, if you can't stand the heat, you ought to be out of the kitchen.
The heat came swiftly. In the American Medical Association newspaper just 8 days after the historic implant, the edition carried a letter which was vehemently critical of the Salt Lake City enterprise. Unfortunately, it said, the public has been misguided regarding the total artificial heart. The letter went on to warn of agonizing discomfort to the patient and to suggest that the operation was a matter of prolonging death rather than life. The writer was Denton Cooley, perhaps the most famous heart surgeon in the world.
I am one of the few people who have seen the effect of the artificial heart on a living human being. It's decidedly uncomfortable in a patient. This device has a rather substantial recoil as the air is pumped back and forth into this device and the valves are snapping shut. It is quite an impact involved.
Dr. Cooley's authority on artificial hearts is beyond question. In 1969, he put the world's first total artificial heart into a patient for lack of a transplant donor. A donor heart arrived, but the patient did not survive, and the case became notorious. During the 70s, the validity of the whole transplant idea was in question, but new anti-rejection drugs have now raised new hopes here as elsewhere. By 1982, Cooley was back in the transplant business. Brain-dead donors were being sought by the Texas Heart Institute, and the hotels across the street were filling once again with hopeful recipients. A year before, he tried again, also unsuccessfully, to use a total artificial heart to keep a patient alive while waiting for a donor. Denton Cooley still believes this is the right role for the artificial heart.
And I'd remind you that the longest transplant patients have been 12 to 13 years. It's inconceivable that an artificial heart would even come close to that type of record.
Substitute for
but Adrian Kantrowitz, who narrowly beat Cooley to America's first transplant 15 years ago, now believes transplants are limited for two main reasons.
Number one, there is some fundamental information that is lacking, and that is that we really don't understand the intimate details of what the rejection process is. Secondly, there is a problem of a source. If there are 1,000 or 2,000 hearts available, that nowhere begins to approach the problem because we need something like 100,000 a year. So that there are basic problems which have not been solved. For the mechanical device, however, there are no real basic problems. There is a problem with a power source, but that is not a problem of lack of information. That is a problem of development. As a matter of fact, I promise you, not only are we starting into this era now, there is no question that this is the way the control of terminal heart disease has to be faced. You must replace the function of a failing heart.
A few pioneers of heart replacement, like Kantrowitz, have been confident all along that the trick was doable. But it took a long time to get this science to the point of human trial. And along the way, literally thousands of calves and sheep have made their contribution to the research. In the early days, the animals died after only hours, or at best days, for a variety of reasons. Then in 1977, a calf survived 6 months, only to die because it outgrew the device. Artificial heart makers and transplant surgeons were confronting their different problems at the same time. Replacing a mere pump was not so simple as it sounded. This recent calf operation at the Texas Heart Institute is checking out a new design of a partial artificial heart, one that simply takes over some of the work of the natural heart, which is left in place. Surgeons working in the abdomen attach a Dacron tube to the body's main artery. That connecting tube into the artery below is the pump's outflow line. In humans, as in calves, the hardware is actually installed down below the diaphragm in the belly.
Looks good, Martha.
Meanwhile, the heart itself, still beating and not even on bypass, is made ready to connect up to the artificial device. A ring connector is sewn onto its left apex, and the suction pipe from the pump, passed through the diaphragm, will simply snap into the ring once the wall of the heart is cut away inside it. So the pump will act in parallel with the left heart, reinforcing it and restoring total blood flow from the small amount a sick heart can deliver to the large amount a healthy body needs. With the pump turned on, total blood circulation can easily be doubled. It's the left side of the heart that's most vulnerable to disease, and this type of pump is called a left heart assist device, or left ventricular assist device if you're being technical.
That's a pretty smooth course into the pump, Jack.
Calves and sheep are resilient and are up and about in a matter of hours after surgery. This sheep had a Jarvic total heart implanted and was filmed on his 103rd day with it. He went on to break the current world record and live nearly 10 months, taking regular exercise. In October 82, Dr. Barney Clark was brought to see this actual animal to help him understand what to expect. The sight apparently didn't put him off. Artificial heart research has had to contend with four main problems, and the first of them is illustrated by this microscope view of blood flowing over a glass surface. The streak is a stream of white cells sticking to the glass where they have detected a minute flaw in the surface. Over time, more and more white cells gather. Any blood contacting surface which is not absolutely flawless will trigger this process and pose the immediate threat of embolism.
A tiny clot will form, which can become fragmented and embolize from the prosthetic device into the circulation and into vital organs, causing the death of a patient or of an animal, as has happened many times. So that the blood-material interface is a major problem. It's not a completed problem. We don't have the final answer.
Bernhard doubts it's even possible to make a smooth enough surface to satisfy blood cells. Instead, he's developed a surface which is deliberately roughened on the microscopic scale, encouraging the changes made by living blood. A new biological surface builds up, imitating the natural interior of blood vessels. The process takes several days. There are two other unwelcome deposits from flowing blood, scar tissue and calcium. After many months in a calf, a smooth polyurethane pumping chamber tends to accumulate calcified material, rather like the deposit left on water pipes by hard water. This too has often been fatal.
And we believe that this problem will not occur in adult humans, that the calcium metabolism of a baby animal that the calf is such that there's a great tendency to calcify there. And in adult animals, such as sheep and goats, maintained long-term, 6 months or more with this or related devices, there's been virtually no problem at all with calcification. So we think that that will not occur in humans, but the only way to really prove it is to see what happens in humans.
A third problem is not what blood does to artificial materials, but what the materials do to the blood. Particularly around valves and other places of high-speed flow, red blood cells tend to get squeezed to the bursting point and become useless. Not even the most painstaking imitation of the shape of a natural heart valve seems to be able to avoid the problem. The dynamics of blood flow in the pump chamber itself also has to be studied closely to minimize red cell destruction. Dr. DeVries was frank about this problem as he searched for a patient who he knew would not qualify for a transplant if the artificial heart failed.
And that's something that humans are just going to have to tolerate. We're going to have to tell them that it's going to destroy blood cells, And it's just going to be a matter of we're going to have to support that the best way we can.
The last of the major problems, and perhaps the most devastating, is caused by the response of skin to having something foreign like the compressed air drive line stuck through it. Human skin, which protects the body from the dirty world outside, is also an effective defender against physical invasion. The outer layer, the epidermis, responds to a foreign object by growing down it, hoping to find its lower end and reseal the body. That well-intentioned response provides, in this case, a pathway for pus and bacteria to spread infection deep into the body.
Infection is a problem that we're going to worry a great deal about also. In the animals, about 80% of them did not have any infection of the drive lines because of the special construction of the tubes we had in there. And we certainly hope that humans are cleaner than animals and they're able to take care of their skin sites a little bit better. And if a patient does, however, get infection, then he's going to have to live with it until the point comes where it will finish him off. And in the animals, we know that this currently takes about 2 or 3 months, maybe sooner, maybe later. But there is nothing more you can do. It is a limitation of the procedure. It is a complication that will end up ultimately in the patient's death. And he's going to have to realize that. Now, the alternative was if he's afraid of infection, afraid of embolism, and if he's afraid of the other problems, then he could just not have the artificial heart and go on and die. That's the alternative he has.
Barney Clark was far from being the first human recipient of an artificial heart. Back in 1975, when these technical problems were even further from resolution, a small group of heart surgeons was authorized by federal agencies to implant left heart assist devices in their patients as a last-ditch measure when all other attempts to restart their hearts after surgery had failed. William Bernhard was one of those surgeons. His technique was to leave the device outside the patient's chest, not implanted. The idea was that after being helped along like this for a few days, the natural heart would recover. In 21 such operations, he's learned a lot but saved few lives.
Well, there are three who are still alive. Not a very great yield. We've lost another one at a month following their operation. The others have all succumbed to one or another of the various complications associated with this problem, namely the failing left ventricle, which is not responding to the operation, and which has been further traumatized by a long period of cardiopulmonary bypass, sometimes many hours. So I don't think it's too unusual to have a low salvage rate, and certainly, that's very important, and it's disappointing that we've not had more live patients.
The National Institutes of Health still put their contract money on the left heart assist device, seeing it as a step along the road toward the total artificial heart. But total heart enthusiasts find that view controversial, since the two devices are based on quite contrary assumptions. One, that the heart will recover if rested. The other, that it won't, so you might as well cut it out. A radical step that few surgeons are willing to take. One man who's made a special study of this controversy is Seattle cardiologist and author Tom Preston.
The investigators who were working on left heart assist devices were in compliance with NIH policy. However, they found three additional problems that they had to work with. First was synchronization. If you have an assist device that's working with the natural heart, you have to synchronize it with the beating of the natural heart. Secondly, it's a problem of venting air. Now, when a piston moves back and forth, as is used on these left heart assist devices, air is created behind it. It has to be there. What to do with the air became quite a problem for the engineers. Thirdly, was the problem of space. Things are rather compact in the heart, in the chest, as they are now. To add yet another artificial device to the existing structures creates a space problem.
Preston's point is easily made by looking at a cross-section of the chest of a man lying on his back. This actual cut-out slab from a male body shows how neatly packaged our anatomy is. If you don't cut the heart out, where else are you going to fit a man-made substitute? That's the reason many left heart assist pumps are put in people's abdomens, where things can move aside easier. The NIH insists on stringent durability testing for artificial hearts, and all five groups under contract to them keep their devices on test for literally years. Mechanical breakdown is actually quite rare as a cause of failure. But if the NIH's philosophy is to use the left heart assist pump for just a few days while the natural heart rests, why worry about long-term durability? The answer is that the next step along the NIH's cautious road toward the total artificial heart is to be a longer-term left heart assist device, one that would stay in the patient for up to 3 months. All five contract groups are working toward this goal, hoping to start clinical trials within the decade.
It's not really clear, however, that there is a good medical use for such a device, and that's because most hearts that fail acutely, as on the operating table, for which there is hope of recovery, will recover within a few days, or at most up to a week or 10 days. Furthermore, if one takes a heart that has recovered maximally and bypasses it as in an assist device for 3 or 4 months, we don't know that that heart won't actually atrophy and therefore be worse at the end of 3 or 4 months than it would have been at 8 days or 10 days.
The NIH research money, $175 million to date, has forced some progress on the problems that total and partial artificial hearts have in common. Smoother surfaces for blood to flow over have been developed. The Boston company that makes this device claims that it will pose so little threat of embolism that recipients will not need routine anticoagulant drugs, a precaution with most artificial hearts, including the Jarvic model. The molds are coated with multiple layers of a special plastic. When dry, the mold itself is dissolved out and the innermost plastic layer removed, leaving a super smooth surface. Once the device is completely assembled, a final seam-free plastic coating will be added, the only surface with which the blood comes in contact. Part of another NIH grant was spent on the purchase of some pigs in a successful attack on the problem of infection around the place where power for an artificial heart enters the body. Dr. Adrian Kantrowitz in Detroit spent 7 years developing a new type of skin button. This man, 63-year-old security guard Haskell Shanks, is the only man ever to have left a hospital with any type of artificial heart in his body. The year was 1971, and Shanks was a patient of Adrian Kantrowitz, who was then as much in the forefront of artificial heart research as he was of transplant surgery. His device is extremely simple, a 7-inch long inflatable bladder sewn into the wall of the main artery, which pulsates in time with the natural heart and relieves the symptoms of mild heart failure. It kept Shanks alive for 96 days before he died of massive infection, the first hint to Kantrowitz of the scale of the skin button problem. After trying 2 more cases with the same result, he called a halt.
We stopped because we had a problem to solve. We solved it, and we're now ready to go.
Kantrowitz hopes soon to be once more taking patients, not pigs, to the operating room to implant his device. He cracked the infection problem by a typically ingenious bit of scientific reasoning.
First, we recognize that this is not a trivial problem, that it is a serious problem. And we looked at the way nature solved this problem. For instance, a tooth comes out through tissue and is sealed, or a horn from an animal comes out through the tissue and it is sealed. And if you look at that at a cellular level, it is sealed at a cellular level because the cells surrounding the hard device interdigitates or is locked to the substance. So we tried to duplicate that.
The key idea is to make a culture of the recipient's own skin cells. That culture is then grown onto a plastic surface, which is peppered with microscopic holes into which the living cells grow. Under the microscope, the junction between cell and plastic is as snug as a lock and key. It looks very like the junction between skin and a tooth, or an animal horn. And Kantrowitz has been able to show that fatal downward growth of the epidermis stopping, and even reversing. This breakthrough has potential not just for his simple device, but the whole spectrum of devices that he thinks are needed.
For the less sick patients, a simpler device will do and has the advantage of being non-obligatory, can turn it off. Then you'll need a group of devices that, because they require putting more power in, the patient must pay more. Not in terms of money, but in terms of having to run the device constantly. Then there will be the sickest group of patients, where both the right side and the left side of their heart are involved, and which will require total substitution of their heart.
The whole spectrum of devices is already in development, but how patients would actually cope with them is an unknown factor. To take a look at the technology and add some thoughts about issues of personal adjustment to it, Nova asked psychiatrist Dr. Daniel Hubert to simulate a day in the life of an artificial heart patient with some of the systems being developed, starting with the actual drive cart that sustained Barney Clark.
Home from the hospital. We've created a model here to show you the compressed air tubes coming out of my body. This is my lifeline, and because of that, I would treat it with tremendous care. For instance, at night, I wouldn't want to roll over on top of it for obvious reasons. So I think I'd train myself to sleep on my back.
The patient has to face alterations to his home as well as his habits, notably installation of a central air compressor with outlets in every room. He'd want to keep the drive cart plugged in every possible moment. Its internal air tanks have only a limited supply of power.
What I'm going to do right now is unplug and very quickly go into the next room.
Pioneering artificial heart patients would also need ramps to get the unwieldy drive cart out the door. The artificial heart designer Robert Jarvic is now collaborating with German researchers to reduce his 375-pound cart to shoulder bag size.
The surgeon in Salt Lake City wondered if it would be possible to play a round of golf connected to this thing. With 80 minutes of air supply in the tanks, I'd probably be able to play a couple of holes anyway. Realistically speaking, outdoor exercise besides golf will become much more practical in a few years when the shoulder bag model is cleared for clinical use. The bag itself weighs about 8 pounds and does everything the big cart does. It operates on batteries that give you about 12 hours in between recharges. It also adjusts the heart rate automatically, depending on the demands of the situation.
It's really hard to imagine another situation where human life is so utterly dependent upon technology and machines. And I think of all the myriad of stresses facing an artificial heart recipient. The issue of dependency is probably the most central one.
Yeah, a little bit too far to the right.
It's obvious that it's more convenient to have an artificial heart design that's smaller than a 375-pound cart. And common sense would lead you to believe that dependence may not be the same. But actually, the issue of dependency is so psychological that really the problem would still be the same.
The next concept Dr. Hubert tried out was an electrically powered left heart assist device. Even more freedom to move around and take exercise is provided by a battery belt that lasts 10 hours between recharges. The skin button is not just an access for the electric cable, but a hole to cope with the problem of venting air.
Because this is a left heart assist device, my own heart is still in my chest, so additional room would have to be made inside of me in order to accommodate this. One way of doing it is to remove a rib, but I'd be left with a rather noticeable lump underneath the skin. An ingenious idea that gets around the problem of having a permanent opening in the skin is to convert the electrical battery power to high frequency then get it across the skin with transformer coils. Now, one way of doing this is to incorporate the primary transformer coil into the battery belt and weave the secondary coil around my waist underneath the skin. As you can see from these rather foreboding scars here, there'd be a lot of surgery involved in that. Of course, there's another way of doing this, is to implant the secondary coil under the skin and then tape the primary over it. This here is the pump that goes along with this system. And here, this extra piece that you see, is an emergency battery. The emergency battery would give me about 30 minutes of power. So conceivably, I could slip off my battery belt and slip into the whirlpool.
Artificial heart recipients would have to have sedentary jobs and be above average size. None of the designs would fit a small man or most women. Miniaturization could only be achieved by doing away with the heartbeat. To provide a steady flow of blood, this little centrifugal pump is all that would need to be implanted.
It wouldn't require an opening in the skin because the drive motor sits outside and drives the pump by magnetic coupling. The surfaces don't actually have to touch in order for the system to work.
25 patients have been sustained on this type of pump for short periods. It saved the lives of 4 of them. But whether a human being could live permanently without a pulse is a totally open question.
There's another artificial heart design we need to take a look at, but it gets us back to the same problem of fitting a lot of hardware inside of the body. This rather large pump with controls would be fitted into the chest by removing a rib. The pump is powered by hydraulic energy, which comes up through this tube.
On the other end of the tube is an engine module implanted in the pelvis. Energy to drive the engine is stored in the form of heat, a pool of molten salt, which is remelted by electricity at any convenient time, while driving to work, for instance. This is a working model of the type of engine used in the device. All you need to do is supply heat to one end of the cylinder, and away she goes. The old principle of the Stirling engine's been updated and miniaturized for artificial heart power. But this design is by far the most complex and has many more moving parts than its competitors.
The reason this system exists, historically, is that it's an adaptation of an earlier model that was intended to be powered by radioactive plutonium. A plutonium capsule would heat up and stay hot for up to 10 years. In other words, plutonium is the only source of power that could be implanted in the body and forgotten. With a nuclear-powered heart inside of my body, I could conceivably move about undetected.
He may be undetected, but is he dangerous? Walking around with half a tablespoonful of plutonium-238 in his chest. As a matter of fact, the plutonium can be shielded so that the radioactivity he and those around him receive is very low. A greater potential danger is the possibility of his meeting a violent death, spilling the lethal contents of his thorax. In the early 70s, the Atomic Energy Commission sponsored a study to find out whether the prototype plutonium capsule would survive any credible accident. These pictures, never before released to the public, are part of its official record. The capsule survived a fire that would have incinerated the man around it. It survived a simulated earthquake accident, assuming a whole building fell on the unfortunate implantee. It survived a fall from a high building, although bent out of shape. Attack with a .45 caliber handgun punctured the case, but the inner shield still held. It took a high-velocity rifle at point-blank range to destroy not just the man, but the capsule. The simulation assumed the body was left in the open to decompose, and under those barely credible conditions, the danger was dramatically obvious.
In 1973, a report of the Artificial Heart Assessment Panel of the National Institutes of Health addressed the issue of a nuclear-powered source for an artificial heart. Let me read from this report. A fundamental moral question is raised by the possibility that implantation of nuclear-powered artificial hearts in specific individuals in order to prolong their lives will result in injury to other members of the population, including future generations. It should be noted that even though the number of individuals who might sustain injury may be very small, the injury sustained by few such persons may be substantial. It's clear, however, that this report has not really stopped the investigation into the nuclear-powered artificial heart. In fact, various government agencies have spent at least $20 million in the time since then on development of a nuclear power source.
It has been developed. It has been tested in animals. There is some further development needed, but it is a politically unacceptable solution. You cannot say the word nuclear energy.
Well, I think it should not be allowed for two reasons. One, the health hazards. As this report points out, there is a hazard not only to the person using the instrument, but to those around. Secondly, there's a health hazard to people who may be accidentally exposed by accidental rupture of the capsule. There's enough plutonium in one of these power sources to provide a lethal dose for 50,000 people.
As for Adrian Kantrowitz, does he, as a scientist, accept the political arguments against the nuclear heart?
Certainly not. I mean, not everything that has the word nuclear in it is bad. I am obviously, like many thinking people, opposed to nuclear war. I think that is horrendous. I think that is unthinkable. And that has the word nuclear in it. But I am not opposed to nuclear energy to make electricity. And I'm not opposed to using available nuclear energy to save people's lives.
Politics, one way or another, has been part of this enterprise all along, ever since Denton Cooley made his first bold move in 1969. Development of the Jarvic heart is now going ahead off University of Utah premises in a private corporation started by artificial organ pioneer Willem Kolff, of which Robert Jarvic is now president. The reason is simple. Jarvic and Kolff's insistence on going straight for a total artificial heart rather than a left heart assist pump does not fit the NIH's cautious stepwise approach. Knowing that government money would not be available for a human total heart program, they went looking for venture capital. They got it. The Jarvic heart and all its accessories could be big business one day at a unit price of $20,000. The decision to go for a human implant was made by a partnership of this corporation and the University of Utah, and the NIH, which did not approve the plans, found itself outflanked. Clinical trials are approved not by them, but by the Food and Drug Administration. Behind-the-scenes manipulation began immediately in Washington.
The NIH had no formal mechanism for influencing the FDA, but they did convene a special committee, a artificial heart working group, which looked at the entire problem and the application of the Utah group. Not unexpectedly, this working group came up with the recommendation that left heart assist devices be used in preference to total artificial implanted hearts.
There are complications with left ventricular assist device that you would not have with the artificial heart. An example of this is that up to about a year ago, 177 left ventricular assist devices were placed in the world from about 81 to back into 75. All of these, almost 95% of them had to be turned for bleeding. And the problem with that is that you have a beating heart muscle with a cannula sticking on it, and bleeding comes into the place where it's moving. In the artificial heart, you remove the heart and you're sewing onto relatively inactive portions. You don't have the interaction problems. So I think in the future, the left ventricular assist device is going to have a tremendous, important impact on medicine, maybe even more than the total artificial heart. But right now, the clinical experience is dismal.
Regardless of any NIH influence in the whole process, the FDA ultimately did approve the application of the Utah team. However, it was on a very restricted level. It was essentially the same approval as for the left heart assist device. And this was confining to the Utah team because it meant that they had to wait for somebody who was effectively dying on the operating table.
And the success rate is going to be very similar to that with left ventricular assist devices, because that's the same thing they went through.
Subsequently, they made another application to the FDA, which was approved in June of 1982, allowing them to implant the total artificial heart in a patient who had a chronic end-stage heart problem, such as a cardiomyopathy.
It's another ballgame altogether. Those are fairly healthy people otherwise, and I think the chances of success are very good on those that group.
It should come as no surprise that ultimately the patient chosen for the operation was just such a patient with a cardiomyopathy.
The Barney Clark case was probably the most publicly conducted clinical experiment in history.
Now, his status. He's doing quite well. The CAT scan.
Day by day, Chase Peterson, University Vice President and Elder of the Mormon Church, educated the world's media on Clark's step-by-step progress into the medical unknown. The second operation on day two to mend a leaking lung. The frightening bout of seizures day five. Medical men are accustomed to discussing such details only with each other and the immediate family. After a period of recovery, day 13 brought another dramatic announcement from Peterson.
At 9:45 this morning, which was 5 hours into his 13th day of the artificial heart, Dr. Clark had a sudden drop in his blood pressure. The pressure dropped down to about 80 over 40, where it had been in the range of 140 over 80.
After 12 days of Peterson's coaching, the assembled media were beginning to appreciate technicalities almost as much as the human side of the story.
Within his body physiology. He kissed his wife, at least in the act of blowing a kiss toward her, and was taken to surgery.
What turned out to have happened was a simple but very nearly lethal mechanical breakage, rare but by no means unprecedented in the animal experiments. In the main valve on the left heart, the metal strut, which limits the travel of the valve disc as it flips back and forth, had broken right there. It took just 25 minutes of surgery, more engineering really, to replace it, and Clark was recovering from his third operation in 13 days. As goodwill messages came in from all over the world, Peterson's lectures ceased, and the hospital tried to settle down to the festive season.
Giddy up, let's go, let's go.
Nobody in the hospital, though, could quite forget the man lying up on the third floor, attached to a clicking and hissing drive cart that was pumping his life blood 100,000 times a day.
Come on, it's lovely weather, the first day better together with you. Outside the snow is blowing and friends are calling you.
By the 1st of March, Clark was exercising daily and was well enough to meet the public at last via a taped interview with his surgeon, William DeVries.
Do you remember what this whole thing's been like? Got any words of advice for somebody that was going through this again? If they were to come and sit and ask you what it was like, what would you tell them?
Well, I tell them that it's worth it. There's no alternative. They either die or they have it done.
It's been hard for you, hasn't it, at times, Barney?
Yes, it's been hard, but the heart itself has pumped right along. And I think it's doing well.
You know, it's hard to... People always wonder, well, what is a success? What does it mean in the first cases? And it's very easy to say ahead of time that what we will learn, no matter what happens, will make it a success. But I think that's kind of begging the issue. My definition of success is that we put that patient, that heart in a patient, and can talk to that patient. And that patient says, yes, this whole thing is worthwhile to me. I'm glad I did it. My life extended by this has been worth something to me, and I'm glad I'm able to contribute to the whole program.
There's been a lot of talk about the condition of Barney Clark after he was operated. That is to say that he was so sick that this led to his ultimate demise, and that perhaps artificial hearts should be put in patients who aren't quite so sick at the start. This brings up a very important problem for all of us, because here we are using or proposing to use a device that is very limited in its applicability right now and its success. And already we're speaking of enlarging the scope of its use. It raises the whole question of who should get the artificial heart. Should it go only to people who can afford to pay for it? Should it go to everyone who wants it? The government, in fact, is caught in a very serious dilemma here, because the artificial heart has been sustained, it's been nurtured, it's been subsidized by the federal government through the NIH. Some other commercial groups are involved, to be sure, but mostly it's been government money. Can the government say, we will give this heart only to certain people who qualify and not to others? I think not.
We have to try to think of rehabilitation in the sense of returning the patient to his family, hopefully to a job where he can make a contribution, not only to society, but to the gross national product. And since this is very expensive technology, one has to think of how we can pay for that with our system of payment for health costs.
The Barney Clark case was perhaps a little unusual in its protracted and very expensive course, but that cost approximately $250,000. If we expect or anticipate $100,000 per case at 30,000 people in this country per year who are candidates for such hearts. That would add up to $3 billion a year just for artificial hearts. Now that happens to be about 3/4 or more of the entire budget of the National Institutes of Health. That's a lot of money. We have to ask, when there are people in this country, some 22 or 25 million people who have no medical insurance, people who can't get ordinary medical care, are we willing to spend $3 billion on essentially what we call a halfway technology that is palliative at best, which by the best estimates will prolong life perhaps 6 months?
Yes. It is expensive. It is less expensive to let a patient die. That's simple. It costs $400 to bury him. It is more expensive if you want to keep the patient alive. That is why my life has been concerned with keeping people alive. So I'm not going to change my philosophy.
On the 24th of March, 1983, the University of Utah summoned the media one last time to hear about Barney Clark's death. He had lived 3.5 months, about as long as an experimental animal, as Denton Cooley had predicted.
Last night, we lost a very dear friend and a man that we believe will forever stand as one of the greatest pioneers in the history of the advancement of medical research. I'm going to ask Dr. DeVries now to talk briefly about those terminal hours.
We took him into the intensive care, and at that time it was obvious that he was having a great deal of difficulty from many sources and many.
DeVries
many
as a person responded to his patient's death with dignity, but to DeVries, the scientist, this was the expected endpoint of a scientific experiment. The exact cause of death is less important than the proof it gave that the major ongoing problems of artificial hearts could be kept under control. Like virtually all scientific experiments, this one caused no overnight revolution. It simply gathered data that could be gathered no other way. And DeVries paid tribute here to Barney Clark, not just as a patient, but as a scientific co-investigator.
And this courageous man's heart was turned off.
Did he think he had the quality of life that he wanted? I suspect he would say no. He wanted much more. I would want much more. But he did a great thing. And if other people do get a quality of life that is more obviously satisfactory, they better thank Barney Clark.
This child is a victim of one of the very few inherited diseases that are understood in precise detail. Genetic engineering could save her life. But once we begin tampering with human genes, where do we draw the line?
Yeah, for 600.
There is the question or the concern that someday it might be possible to, in fact, manipulate our genetic composition and remake human beings.
There are also technical problems in applying this new science to human disease.
These kinds of manipulations still are problematical. They do damage to cells on occasion.
But some who are closely involved are impatient to begin this journey into the medical unknown.
Gene therapy is perhaps a little bit of a risk, but so is everything we try on these patients.
The time is now.
A parent, a child, and a physician willing to take the genetic gamble. Next on NOVA.
Major funding for NOVA is provided by this station and other public television stations nationwide. Additional funding was provided by the Johnson & Johnson family of companies, supplying healthcare products worldwide. And Allied Corporation, a world leader in advanced technology products for the aerospace, automotive, chemicals, and electronics industries.
A bug specialist for the butterflies in the stomach for $1,000.
That'll be a little easy.
6-year-old Erin McCarthy is not one of life's big winners. She lacks the natural immunity the rest of us depend on to combat the sources of infection all around us. Seeing her like this, it's hard to realize she has a life-threatening disease. That's partly because Erin on her bad days would be a very disturbing sight.
You killed him, man. I don't like that.
It's also a testimony to the tireless efforts of her parents, her doctors, and her expert home nurses.
You have to get me the rubber band.
Okay, Erin, let's get you started tonight, okay? Can we get you hooked up?
A bug.
Life in this house is dominated by the battle to keep Erin alive. Her playmates are discreetly screened. A minor cold could be lethal to her.
Do you want to empty these like you usually do?
Okay.
Erin, do you want to empty these like you usually do? Yeah, see?
Green.
The cause of her condition is a lack of a natural enzyme called ADA, a crucial chemical link in the immune system. That in turn is caused by an unlucky combination of genes coming together from both sides of the family. And her parents had no idea this devastating legacy lay hidden within them.
No, we didn't. It had never shown up in a family history or anything. It came as a total surprise and shock.
The chances of one person who's a carrier marrying another person